Wow, it's really windy outside. Hi guys, it's Steffi from the Novelty Corner. Welcome back to my channel. It's really windy outside and I apologize if you can hear any of that sound. But without further ado, I'm going to get straight into my wrap up for this week. It was the last week of the school holidays and oh my God, what the hell is happening with the lighting? Is anything going to go right today? I don't know. It was the last week of the school holidays for me, which means I'm going back to work the day that this goes up on my channel. So yes, I'll be back into the working person thing. Because it was the last week, I actually got a whole stack of reading in. So this week I read 9-ish things. I say things because you're going to see in a minute that some of them are not technically books. I read a total of 2,333 pages and I'm up to 208 books for the year. I did go to some bookish events this week. I did go to the Inky Awards at the State Library of Victoria. The Inky Awards are a set of young adult book awards that are selected by young adult readers. So their judges are young adult readers and young adults vote for the gold and the silver Inky. So the gold Inky Award goes to an Australian young adult book and the Silver Inky Award goes to an international young adult book. This year, Words in Deep Blue by Kath Crowley won the Gold Inky and Radio Silence by Alice Oseman won the Silver Inky. It was just a really nice event. It was super short. It was held inside the State Library and the young adult judges who spoke and presented the awards were really fantastic. And I think it's such an important thing that there is a book award that is judged entirely by young adult readers because those are who the books are written for. I also took part in the Getgraphic Readathon. I didn't complete everything that was in my TBR that was posted last week, but I did get through quite a few things. So you will hear about them in this particular wrap up as well. Okay, now onto the books. The first book that I read was Running on the Roof of the World by Jess Butterworth. And this was a book that my school's librarian gave to me to read over the holidays. And it is set in Tibet. It is a middle grade book. It is the story of Tash, whose parents have been seized by soldiers. And she and her friend have to escape Tibet and they try and cross the mountains to seek assistance from the Dalai Lama. This was just a really interesting middle grade read. And I think what it does, it will highlight to younger readers that not everyone's life is or was as simple as theirs. And I just thought it was so beautiful. The chapters were super short. It was really quick and easy to read. Each chapter has beautiful title pages the whole way through. If this was my copy of the book, I probably would have started coloring it in, but it was absolutely beautiful. I gave it 4 out of 5 stars, and this is a 2017 release. Next, I read The Special Ones by M. Bailey. Again, this was a book that my school's librarian gave me to read. Obviously, it has not been catalogued because she was a little bit wary about whether or not this one was appropriate for a primary school library, and it is not. It is a Love Oz YA cult thriller story, so yes, very not appropriate for primary school. It is the story of Esther, who is one of the special ones, a group of 4 teenagers who live their lives on camera. They live in isolation, they live off the land, and they live naturally. People who follow the special ones online believe them to be the reincarnated versions of the special ones who lived many, many years before, who constantly are reborn into new bodies. Esther herself is a very calm character. Each of these special ones inhabit specific traits. Hers is being very calm, very straightforward. Inside, the real Esther is terrified. I enjoyed it as a thriller. I gave it 3.5 out of 5 stars. The first half was really intriguing because it's all told from Esther's perspective. Then about halfway through, we start getting a split point of view and we start seeing from the man who holds them captive's perspective. I don't know if that was 100% necessary. I can see why it was really interesting, but I didn't think it was necessary. What I was really curious about in the second half of the book was the way that society treats victims, the complexity of issues surrounding people who've been held in captivity for long periods of time. The Special Ones was a 2016 release and I really enjoyed it. Tea. Then I read Dracora by Lynette Loney, which was the third book in the Madoran Chronicles series. And I won't say too much about it because it is the third book in the series, except to say that this one was my favorite so far because it involves magical creatures and it's on the front cover, so that can't be a spoiler. And a really cool new world and a really cool twist on explaining the history of Medora. So I gave this one 4.5 out of 5 stars. It was a 2017 release. If you want to talk about this book more, hit me up on social media because I don't really want to give spoilers away to people who haven't read it because it is a fairly recent release. Then I read the last book that I was given to read over the holidays from my school librarian, and this is Warren the 13th and the All-Seeing Eye, and this is a middle grade book and it is really cool. Awesome illustrations the whole way through it. Awesome chapter titles. It is the story of Warren the 13th, who comes from a long line of Warrens, and they have always owned this hotel. However, Warren's father passed away and he has been left the charge of his uncle and his uncle's new wife, who is a very sinister type of auntie called Auntie Anaconda. Warren basically runs this hotel now all on his own because his uncle is lazy and his aunt seems to be only interested in finding the all-seeing eye, mysterious object that appears to have been part of the hotel's history, but yet no one can really say what it is. So it becomes a race between Warren, his aunt, and a whole host of hotel guests to try and find the all-seeing eye. This was funny and cute, and this will appeal to younger readers who like things that are a little bit spooky but aren't scary. And I really enjoyed this. I gave it 4 out of 5 stars, and this particular book was published in 2015. Then I read The Lost Hours by Minette Walters, and this was a book that was sent to me by Alan Unwin for review, so thank you very much. It is a historical fiction book, and it is set during the time of the Black Death. The Black Death arrives in England, and Lady Anne of Devlish decides that she is going to close the borders of her property in her husband's absence, because she believes that is the best way to protect her people, which is sort of in defiance of the church, who believes that confessing your sins will save you from this Black Death, or at least save your soul when you die from it. In doing so, she creates a few problems between the higher class people who live with her, such as her daughter and higher standing members of her family's property, and makes her much beloved of the serfs and the lower class that she cares for. You guys know me and my feelings on historical fiction. I don't tend to pick them up on my own, although I do have a policy that if I'm sent unsolicited books by publishers, I will read them and I will give them a go and I'll give you my honest feedback. I loved this. This was probably the easiest historical fiction book I've read, and it is huge. I loved all of the intrigue. I loved how the motivations of different characters are revealed slowly and they make a whole lot of sense. So actions that take place in the first half of the book suddenly have a new meaning when everything is unraveled towards the end. This is the first book in either a duology or a series. I didn't know that going into it, but I found that out just before I finished reading it. There are quite a few trigger warnings in here. There is some warnings for rape, also for incest, and there are quite a few sexist things given the time period and the belief that women don't know anything. And yet we have a really strong female lead character in Lady Anne who believes in education. She believes that being able to provide safe sanitation and medical treatment for her people will enhance her land's output, basically. I enjoyed this. So this is a 2017 release. I gave it 4.5 out of 5 stars, which I think is probably the highest I've ever given a historical fiction book. And I highly recommend that you pick this one up if you are interested in historical fiction. I read issue 1 of The Punisher, which I've never read a Punisher comic in my life, and it was every bit as violent and brutal as I came to expect it to be. I'm not really going to talk too much about this because it's a single issue one and I don't know the full story of what happens after it. Same goes for Champions issue 1. This is the Marvel Collector Core variant cover, and this is actually my first introduction to the new Miss Marvel character, and in it, she and a few of the younger former members of the Avengers have grouped together to form the Champions based off their need to see a group of superheroes that are willing to look at the impact that they have when they're helping societies. I really enjoyed these. They've just been sitting on my shelf for ages, so I decided to read them. I'm not going to rate them. They're too short. Then I read DC Universe Rebirth Nightwing Volume 2 Back to Bloodhaven, which I loved Dick Grayson. I think he's hilarious and he's got a great sense of humor and personality, and it really comes through in his books. I'm suddenly really confused about what's happened with the DC Rebirth universe while I was reading this, but I still really enjoyed the story, and it has, you know, one scene in it that breaks my Barbara Gordon Dick Grayson OTP shipper's heart, but I understand why it happened. Yeah. This was just fun. So this version of Nightwing has never worked in Bloodhaven, and he is introduced to the city and he decides to make his way back there, hence why it's called Back to Bloodhaven. And he teams up with a group of reformed supervillains who are being framed for crimes they didn't commit in the city. And there's this undercurrent of politics as the politicians in the city are trying to make the city more appealing to tourists, even though it has such a high crime rate. I really enjoyed it. I gave it 4 out of 5 stars. I think this was published this year, or at least it was in this compilation. Nightwing's just a really fun, solid character to pick up and read whenever you feel like it. What is going on with my phone? See, so many distractions today. Next book, which is technically 3 books in 1. It is the Star Wars Dark Empire trilogy in graphic novel form. Again, this was for the Get Graphic Readathon, just like my Nightwing comic. As sad as it is to say, this book disappointed me. I only gave it 3 out of 5 stars. I don't know. The artwork is terrible in it. Don't like the artwork, which is a shame because the cover art and the back art, great. So this story takes place 10 years after the death of Darth Vader and the Emperor. And what we quickly realize is that the Emperor is very much alive and is using clone bodies to transfer himself into when old bodies die. Luke, while trying to learn as much as he can about the Jedi and the Force in order to train future Jedi, becomes trapped in sort of this web as he tries to go up against the Emperor on his own. And amongst the story, you have a whole bunch of other political things going on, battles and whatnot. And it's all tied up in the reveal that the Emperor is still alive and still controlling the Imperial army. In this particular story arc, you have the birth of Anakin Solo, which I forgot happened in this particular story arc, but you know, nevertheless, very cool. And there were appearances of some of my favorite characters, Wedge Antilles and also Winter. But yeah, 3-star read, fell flat. And there was parts where you had to really push through to get through this. So sad to say, not my favorite Star Wars read. That was my last full read. Really quickly, I did get through about 50% of Warcross by Marie Lu, which is the YA Chronicles book of the month. So I'll talk about more about this next week. And I've got a secret project brewing for Warcross, just for myself, because I no longer am subscribed to any subscription boxes. So I'm putting together my own Warcross subscription box. I'm really enjoying it. I can see why some people probably wouldn't enjoy this as much, but I'm really enjoying it. But we'll see what I think at the end of next week. Oh my God, these are heavy. So these are all the books that I read this week. I'm pretty pleased with my efforts because I am going back to work and I know I'm not going to be able to read this much in a week for a very long time until the school holidays. So 11 weeks and counting, people. In the comments, let me know what you have been reading this week. I hope that you've had a fantastic reading week so far. I hope that wherever you are in the world, you are having a wonderful day, and I'll catch you guys in my next video. Thanks so much for watching. Bye guys.